We come humbly bow before you. Father God, we are asking this morning that you will give us a personal visit. Father, we're asking that you allow your Holy Spirit to rain on us this morning. We call ourselves in the call of worship, Father God, but every day we should be worshiping you, Father God. We should not have to just be called to worship you, but it should be on our tongues every day. So yes. Forgive us.
Yes, God.
Forgive us, oh God, for not giving you the worthiness and the honor and the praise, Father God, that we should. But Father God, we are here. And we're asking that you will take our praise and our worship as a sweet, sweet sound.
Yes.
As a sweet, sweet sound. Father, as we go deep down within to bring it all up. Father, we just want to give it all to you
yes.
this morning.
Hallelujah.
Father, we've had crazy weeks, Father God. We've had crazy years, months, days, but God, you have been faithful.
Hallelujah.
Great is yes. thy faithfulness, Lord God,
Hallelujah.
Our Father. Morning by morning. New mercies we have seeked, and you have been so faithful as to do that. Father, we just can't praise you enough because of your faithfulness, our unfaithfulness, and you never, ever hold it against us, Father. The blood covers it all, so let the enemy decease. Let him not confuse us. Let him not blame us, Father God, but help us to fall on our face and give it to you, Heavenly Father, for you are our God. We are claiming you as our God, and we are your people.
In the name of Jesus.
Blow your breath upon us this morning, oh God. Help us to love as you have called us to love. Help us to be that which you want us to be. I'm asking right now, Father, that anything that is hampering us from giving it all to you this morning, that you move. All the things and the troubles of home, all the things and the troubles of people, all the things of trouble on the job, put it aside for us, Lord. Let us focus on the heavens. Let us focus on you, oh God, for you are peace. For you are our joy. You are our strength this morning. And that's all we're calling upon, Father God. Just give us the peace and the joy that your precious Holy Spirit provides. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Our song this morning is We Have Come Into This House in your hymnal book 224. We have come into this house. Certainly, that's why I'm here, y'all.
Psalms 122, verse 1. Let us go to the house of the Lord. We have come into his house, page 224. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name to worship him. We Christ the Lord.
worship him, Christ the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If you will remain standing with me, we're going to read today. I'll be reading to you, but if you will turn your hymnals to 735. In your hymnal book 735, The Armor of God, from Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. Sister Rita, I have to say, when I looked up and saw you,
amen.
Amen.
All right.
My heart is glad.
Amen.
It's just to see the strength. You just don't know you're showing up.
Praise
whether you're feeling good or bad, but to see you standing there, I say, Lord, what am I complaining about? What is my issues? When I look at you, it's all good. So thank you, Sister Rita, for just fighting your way coming here. I just wanted to personally thank you, as I'm sure we all do. Your faithfulness, my Lord.
Hallelujah.
Be strong in the Lord.
Amen.
And in the strength of his might, put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of these dark places, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Stand firm. Stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shown your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, in addition to all taking up the shield of faith, and which you will be able to extinguish all the flames and arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is what? Which is the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Amen. You may be seated. That's the most powerful weapon we could have, y'all.
Yes.
Our second hymn for today, To God Be the Glory. Page 56. We don't take credit for none of this.
Psalms 126, verse 3. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Amen.
Amen.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the grave like that I may go. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, to Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done. Verse 2, oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus, a pardon, we praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory. Great
things he has done.
Great things he has taught us. Great things he has done. And great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But pure is and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when yes, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through
know, sometimes these songs just kind of go over our head, but praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Come to the Father through the Son and give him the glory for great things he has done. Amen. There is something, Pastor, to be said for them old hymns. Them hymns, when you ain't got no music and you got to sit there and hum out a line, it's all good.
Amen.
Our announcements for today. We have the general announcements. They're in your bulletin. Also, I've included the passcodes for the Women's Sunday School as well as for the Wednesday night Bible class. Amen. They're held in Zoom. So if you hang on to your bulletins and Streamland, I'm sorry. Maybe I'll try to get Pastor to put a slide with this information on there for you so that you can begin to participate with us even more. Okay. We also have Zelle. We've been forgetting to... Oh, they are up there. Who put them up there? You good. We're glad the passcodes are up there and Zelle is up there. People I have been forgetting, or we have been forgetting to mention Zelle, and people have been calling and asking if we have Zelle. So yes, we do. Just make sure it's Keystone. Don't forget that dot in between Keystone.church, okay? Yahoo@yahoo.com. Okay. Helen Gillard Scholarship Concert. It is next Sunday at 4 p.m.
Amen.
If you guys are a part of Facebook, Melinda had a beautiful, I don't know, what would you call it? Just a short clip video of her music. And I invited everyone out, and if on my Facebook, on her Facebook, and if you're friends with somebody, please put it on your Facebook page that we will be featuring Miss Melinda Jones in concert next week, along with our wonderful, loving Bridget Wright. She's agreed to come with us. So it's on Facebook, but you know, by word of mouth is always the best thing. So if everybody in here today would just pick up the phone and call somebody and tell somebody, we can get this thing rolling, okay? In addition to that, we are going to have refreshments after that. What happens is during the time that you guys are down in the hall, we will be counting the funds, and we like to try to give the people that are present an idea of how much that we have gathered, how wonderfully blessed they have blessed us. So please don't forget, after the concert, we will be going downstairs for refreshments. Our quarterly business meeting is the following Sunday on April the 28th. We've been doing very good with getting back on track with our quarterly business meetings and different meetings that we should be holding. So please mark your calendars and make sure that you can attend. It's after morning service. It is not on Zoom or streaming. So please come to the sanctuary for us. Happy birthday, Miss Jada Pearson Ware. That's one of your granddaughters?
Jakia.
Is that a granddaughter or daughter?
Yeah, granddaughter.
Granddaughter, okay. And to Mother Novella Heron. Give them a call. Let's bless them and wish them happy birthday. Whose picture is this, Pastor? Whose little kids are these?
Look at that picture, good girl.
Who is that?
Look at that picture.
It's not my family. I don't know. This is for Mother's Day. We are going to be doing generational portraits, okay? That means invite grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and everybody to take a picture. Yeah, we want the mothers and the daughters, but we're trying to get everybody in. This is a time where if you know, things are so costly, but here you can come to the church and take a family photograph, okay, with all us, all y'all in your family. I think it's a wonderful idea. Something that we all say we want to do, but we never do. So who's the family, Pastor?
That's your pastor.
That's your pastor.
Oh, is that your family, Pastor? Which one are you?
I'm on the far right. My youngest sister is next to, between me and my brother, Daryl, and then there's Rosalind Elise.
Oh, hey, amen. I know all y'all knew that, but I'm sorry, I had to ask. I didn't recognize
next
it.
Next week.
Next week after, this is Mother's Day, right? Mother's Day. It will be done on Mother's Day Sunday, okay? And we will start signing up for next week.
Amen.
Okay, so that Justin will be, of course, our photographer, so that he will know exactly how much equipment, how much film. There will be a backdrop. It'll be all that. It's just another hallelujah good time with the mothers. Let us love on our mothers, those of us that have our mothers still here. And then let's love on the honor of the family that is remaining, okay?
Amen.
All right. Amen. That's just wonderful.
This is not coming until June, but I just want to remind everybody of the corporate prayer. We're having another corporate prayer on June the 23rd at 9:30 downstairs in Fellowship Hall. It was such a blessing, the first one we had. Provided us with a lot of strength and to keep on going. So please, more prayer, more power. So join us on June the 23rd, and our local CAPS meeting is here as well. Our prayer list, we want to keep Brother Matthews in prayer. He's been moved from hospice to a home where I'm sure he wants to pass comfortably at home. So they've made arrangements where he is at home with his pastor. All the bereaved families, Tenney and the Williams family, please keep them in prayer. It takes more than a moment sometimes. We would like to, Beverly Patton is in the hospital again to receive her second round of chemo. So keep her in prayer as well as her husband in prayer. Also, please read the rest of the list that is in our bulletin, because we need to not forget the people that are the sick and the shut-in and our seniors. We must embrace them so that they still always feel a part of us, because they are a part of us. They've had the many, the strong backs that we've made it on, so let's not forget them, okay? All right. Our meditation song, Just a Closer Walk to Thee, page 564, Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
Page 564, Philippians reads 4:13. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. We will sing verses, the first verse and the third verse. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus keeps me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, as I walk. Let me walk close to thee. Well, we'll sing verse 2. Through this world of toil and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, none but thee. When my feeble life is o'er, time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely to that kingdom shore, to thy kingdom shore. Yes, just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea, and it's a daily walking.
Yeah.
Father, we are honored to be called your children. We thank you just for that opportunity. Lord, you tell us many are called, but few are chosen. Thank you for the opportunity to be in your great family. Father, we continue to pray for those that have neglected the call.
Yes.
Those, Lord, who have turned a deaf ear to you. You are long-suffering.
Yes.
Father, teach us to be long-suffering with those that annoy us, those that, Lord, test our patience, test our nerves. We need to learn from you, your patience, your love. It endures, Lord, it endures. And God, we can learn so much from you. Powerful attributes that you have. Being long-suffering, being holy. You call us to be holy.
Yes.
God, we thank you for your holiness.
Yes.
You tell us to step out from among them and separate ourselves.
Yes, Lord.
God, that's what we want to do spiritually. We want to be separate from this earth and the sin that so easily entangles us. And again, Lord, it's only by your power that we could do that.
Yes.
So we thank you for your spirit that
you,
walks
Lord.
With us, that talks with us, Lord, that guides us each and every day. Father, I think about those that are ill and sick and that are removed from this family. They can't come out. Lord, be with them today. Be with them in power and in might. May they remember who you are, regardless of how they feel. May they remember, Lord, and see you for who you are.
Yes, Lord.
God, I thank you for this church.
Thank you, Lord.
God, we pray your protection over it. There are so many false gods and truths that we run after because they tickle our ears and there's something that we find exciting. And God, forgive us that we find that more exciting than you.
Yeah.
Lord, we confess our sins before you. We've fallen short.
Yes, we
seek after these things in place of you. So Lord, forgive us for putting them before you. God, accept our humble apologies and receive us back into your presence. Because we know sin separates us from you. God, for our seniors, for our sick and shut in, for those that who are just hurting, who feel anxious and overwhelmed by the daily grind. God, we ask that you would be with them, that you would show yourself strong. God, that you would speak a word into their lives, into their spirit, and remind them that you are truly the one that delivers. You sent a deliverer in Moses, but you are the one that delivers. So, Father, we ask that you would continue to deliver your children. Continue to call your children, Lord. Weigh on our hearts heavy and help us not to turn that deaf ear to you, but to respond, Lord, to respond. We don't actually begin to do things until we do what you ask us to do.
We hear you, but Lord, it's until we begin to do what you ask us, that's when we hear you. That's when we are walking according to your will. That's when, Lord, when the blessings fall, when we're walking according to your will.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
And Father, for those that are outside of your will, Lord, we pray for them. We pray for them, Lord, asking that you would continue to strive with them. We know your word says that you won't always strive, but Lord, we think about our families that haven't turned to you yet, and we don't want them to miss that opportunity to be in your great family. So Father, we pray for them. Well, we pray for them where they are. May you show them the sin in their life. May you open up their eyes, because we can't do it. It's only by your Spirit that we realize that we are sinful and we've fallen short of you. God, we thank you for each person here today, asking that you would minister not only in song, through your word, but Lord, through the spoken word. So we pray for John as he's speaking with us today, the word that you have given him. Guide his thoughts, Lord. May he be careful to say what you say and you alone. Thank you for the different ministries that go on here. Lord, we're so grateful that you're reviving our youth ministry. That the children can have a place to learn about you. You tell us to train up our children in the way to go. And you said children. So that means we need to start early. Planting the seeds so that when the word comes, they can recognize it. And others would come and water, and your sun would shine upon it so that their spiritual beings would grow. Keep our children, Lord. Plant a hedge of protection around them. Keep them from the enemy. And God, again, we're so grateful what you have done already. We look over our lives, and Lord, we see here where you've done something. We look there, and you've done something. And Lord, we see before where you're working out something for us, Lord. So you, Lord, have done so much for us, and we thank and we praise you for that. We just ask that you would continue to do that. Continue to minister to us as your children. Father, we pray all these things in your blessed Son's name, Christ Jesus, the anointed one who came and died and rose from the grave. No one else has that claim. And this is why we put our trust in you. This is why we put our trust in you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I do just want to say just a little bit more about Reverend Matthews. Reverend Matthews came through Keystone. Some of y'all, it was before your time, but godly man. Godly man, he and his wife, she has gone on before him, but he's now in a state where his body is shutting down, and he's being cared for by the previous pastor over at the Albany Youth Center's daughter and her husband. So that was really good that he doesn't have to spend his last days in a facility, but can be with family, people that he know. Continue to pray for Reverend Matthews, and also for Beverly. A lot of y'all know Beverly. She was here before I came back to the church, but she's going through chemo also. She's been diagnosed with leukemia, and speaking with her, she just said this has been the toughest 2-3 years of her life. And Thank the Lord for Deborah and Otis who have been ministering to them, going back and forth to the doctor, encouraging the family. And you don't know what it is until you get sick. You see people and you see them going through. And until you're there, you just don't know. And that's why Deborah had to take a little time this morning and say, thank you, Sister Rita, for pushing out. Thank you.
Praise God.
When you're going through it, it's so difficult. But you know, you keep your eyes on the Lord, and sometimes we waver. That's the truth. We waver. But God is faithful. But God. Yeah, Renee, but God.
Say that.
But God. So, yeah, I want to say thank you for pushing out, too. Thank you for being obedient to the Spirit and being an example to us. Because we want to give up with less on our plates.
Amen. You better say that.
So we thank you for being an example.
Yes.
An example to us. May the Lord continue to bless you. Touch your body, touch your spirit, and strengthen you in all what you're going through.
Amen.
Just wanted to say that, and I'm kind of lost in the program. Where are we? I'm introducing John. Our singing. We'll have our small choir today. But we're going to have them nonetheless to minister to us in music.
Amen.
Praise God.
Just wanna praise you forever and ever.
Glory and honor. Thank you, Father, for blessing me. Amen. It's an individual thing. I can't thank him. I do thank him for blessing y'all, but thank you, Father. Ushers, come forward for blessing me. Glory and honor. I don't know, choir. Every time y'all sing, y'all sound like about 50 people to me. I don't know. Y'all hearing it? The strength and the power. Praise God for your faithfulness. Praise God for your faithfulness. Father, we ask now that you will bless us with finances. Father God, there is so much of your work to be done. So we're asking you now, Father, that you will bless the giver and that you will press it down and shake it up so that it may be used for the uplifting of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for blessing us this morning. Father, as we go forward, we want this to be used to lift your kingdom and for your glory only. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. Amen. Brother Deacon John is going to be bringing the word to us this morning. So let's welcome him.
Amen.
I shared with him just the other day. I say, John, you know, what you're speaking on, spiritual warfare, is just something that I really am interested in bringing the church into, just, you know, getting a little bit more familiar with it so that we, you know, when you don't know, you can't do better, but when you know, you can do better.
Yeah.
So I told him, I say, it's a blessing that you're coming from there because I see us spending a little time in this area in upcoming weeks and sermons. So he's starting. You see, this is going to be part one, so he's going to be back. He will be back with the part two. And at some point, I'd like to piggyback on top of it also. So let's welcome Deacon John Ware, and let's pray for him, too, as he's speaking. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, Keystone. It's good to be with you again. Pray with me as we go to God's word. Father God, I thank you for the opportunity to share your word. Lord, for the gifts you've given me, for the love of your word, love to share, to understanding. Father, anoint my lips and anoint my heart now that I might speak from you, through you. May the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, my Lord, my Redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So good to be with you all again.
Amen.
I want to say thank you because this is an awesome responsibility to speak God's word from his pulpit because salvation is so important. It's the most important thing in this universe for our families to be saved, for our loved ones, for everyone connected to this church, children, adults, and so on. I'll give you a quick bit of history. Growing up, when Keystone was first starting here on this corner, there was a deacon by the name of Dan Page. And Dan Page lived just a couple of feet away from me in the building with his brother, Deacon John Page, with Sister Helen Gillert. Just a couple of feet away from me, from where I live right now, Costner and Fulton, right on the corner. They all lived in that building, a little community. So my father, being from the same little hometown in Mississippi as Deacon Dan Page and John Page, said, J.C., that's what they call him, J.C., his name is John Ware, I'm a junior. He said, J.C., them boys need to be in church. Because my father's father was a pastor. His brother was a pastor. So come from family pastors. And Deacon Dan Page, knowing their background, said, J.C., them boys need to be in church. Keystone had a Bible, summer Bible class to show you how God works. God's faithful people here. So me and my brother, being preteens, would walk down here, the four blocks down here, shuffle down here. And I learned some very important things. Sister Helen Gillert and many others, Sister Pocahontas Jones. I call her my personal godmother. She was Rita's mom, and she was a firebrand. Believed in God. Walked in the Spirit of God. And I learned so much from her, Pastor Lindo. The Blackmans were my Sunday school teachers. I drifted away, preteens. So somehow, God just kept drawing me back here. We were brought up early on in Metropolitan Missionary Baptist Church with Reverend E.F. Ledbetter, because that's where my mother's family was. All of them had migrated from Mississippi, and we were in this big mega, you can call it a mega church, Metropolitan Missionary Baptist Church. But somehow, some way, I kept being drawn back here. So after those preteen days in Bible summer camp here, drifted away, went on, met this crazy guy named Mac White. Bless his heart, him and Joan. They had Bible camps and everything. When I got to high school at Lane Tech, we had a group of us. Now, I'd been away from Keystone for a while. We had a group of us, Tony Jones, Rose Blackman, Daryl Blackman, Delario, Manstro Thorne. There were so many from our high school group that were attending Keystone. I get jarred right back into Keystone. In my college days, Mac followed us. We had formed a Bible study there. So God had me wrapped up in Keystone because we had so many programs, so many developmental things here at Keystone with Sister Edie McShann, Sister McShann, the Tennies, the Joneses, the Blackmans. There were so many families here. Forgive me if I miss any. And it was a very enlightening learning experience. And I'm going to share one little secret to you about my whole learning process. All throughout the time from early stages here at Keystone, we would learn Bible verses. And my little secret is I would always memorize verses in the King James. What I find now, 40, 50 years later, it's so much easier when you use Google to search for verses, because when you memorize in the King James, there are unique words like cometh, goeth,
thee, thou,
and so it's easy because of the browsers are indexed by these unique old English words. So it's easy to find the scriptures you want because they're indexed by this old King James language. So that's one little secret about finding these verses in these days. So God is good.
Amen.
So that's one of my little tidbits. So as I go into scripture, I just want to share something. I want to drop something heavy on you right now about spiritual warfare, part one. As we go into the next slide about where it all began. Spiritual warfare, 2 Corinthians 10, chapter 10, verse 3 through 5 says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations or reasoning and everything that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." We're going to go through that verse a bit later again when I go through some of the scriptures, and I'm going to break that down. But what's interesting, on the eve of my speaking about the spiritual warfare, we see something happening in Israel. What happened yesterday? Iran attacked Israel with a barrage of missiles and drones. Isn't it interesting in Daniel chapter 10 that When Daniel fasted for 21 days, the angel Gabriel came and said, from the first day you prayed, God heard your prayer. He dispatched Gabriel instantly. And for 21 days, Daniel was in warfare with the king of Persia, who resisted him, and the archangel Michael had to come to help him. And this was while Daniel and his fellow Jews were captives who had been bought into Babylon. So who is the king of Persia? Current day, who's the king of Persia? So the crown prince, king of Persia now, is a guy by the name of Reza Pahlavi, and the Ayatollah Khomeini is the supreme leader. But the real king of Persia is a demonic spiritual force.
All right.
And would you not believe who is Persia, the king of Persia? Persia is Iran today. These spiritual forces are still at war. 2,700 years later, in 600 BC, Daniel received this prophecy. Just so, almost 600 years ago. So 2,700 years ago, the king of Persia was warring against Michael and the angels to keep that vision from being understood by Daniel. So fast forward 2,700 years later, a spiritual warfare is going on, and it's spilling over into the physical realm.
Yes.
This is the spiritual battle that we're dealing with. Just happened yesterday, and this is Daniel 10, chapter 10, still happening. The prophecy is still being revealed. So we're going through a spiritual reckoning. So God gives us spiritual discernment to see that there are things taking place in the spiritual world that affect the physical world. So just a tidbit. Just God enlightened me on that today. So the spiritual battle is still going on in heaven between the angels and the demonic forces.
Amen.
In heaven, because these are, the king of Persia is a title that a spiritual demonic force behind the government. These are spiritual forces when it talks about in Ephesians, principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places. These are spiritual forces, and the angel said, after I leave and go back, the prince of Greece will come. If we look back in Daniel, there's a lot of things unpacking. That's a whole different sermon. Babylon had captured the Jews, taken them in. The Persians conquered Babylon, the Medo-Persians. That was the spirit of Persia, the king of Persia, the wickedness. Medo-Persia was conquered by the Greeks, which the angel said he would go back and the prince of Persia, prince of Greece would come. So that's a whole nother history, but that's interesting that this all happened yesterday to enlighten us about the spiritual warfare. So where did it all begin? It said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. But what this account in Genesis does not tell us, as we go to the next slide, what this account doesn't tell us is what happened before the earth was created in the celestial spiritual realm. For this, we have to refer to Job 38. I know you can't read all this, but I'll read it for you. Job chapter 38, verses 4 through 7. When God was rebuking Job in chapter 38, he said, where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched the measuring line across it, or what were its footings? Or who laid its cornerstone? Verse 7. While the morning stars sang together, and all the angels shouted for joy. So when the earth was created, the angels or the spiritual beings, they were created before earth and mankind.
Right. Yes.
Hebrews 1:14 tells us, are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who inherit salvation? So here we see Satan's pride and ultimate fall was in Isaiah, it tells us, Ezekiel 28, verses 12 through 17, it tells us, God said, son of man, take up a lamentation upon the king of Tyrus, or the king of Tyre. That was an actual physical king, but also was a satanic, demonic force. Say unto him, and they're speaking of Satan here, Thus said the Lord God, thou seedest of the sun, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou was created. Thou, speaking of Satan again, he was Lucifer at the time. Verse 14 of chapter 28. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth. I have set thee so. Thou wast upon the holy mountain of God. Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created until iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence. And thou hast sinned, therefore I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of God, and I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of brightness, of thy brightness. I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings that they may behold thee. And as we continue into the next slide, Isaiah 14, chapter 14, verses 12 through 15, tells us again about Satan's fall. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. This is famously known as the five I ams. I wills, the five I wills, Satan's pride. Go on to the next slide. So we put these all together, and from Revelations 12, 7 through 9, we found out about this war, a battle that was going on in heaven. That included Satan's fall. Revelations 12, chapter 12, verse 7 through 9. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was his place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And Satan took a third of the angels with him. In that same chapter 12, if we read verses 3 to 4, it says, and there appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, referring to angels, and to cast them to earth. So sometime between the creation of earth and the creation of the celestial beings, Satan rebelled. And there was a war in heaven. Mm-hmm. Satan took a third of the angels with him. But Satan only has a short time. Revelations 12:12. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he had but a short time. In Luke chapter 10, verses 18, Jesus told the disciples when they returned from casting out the demons, they were so excited. He said, Lord, even the demons are subject to us. But he said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. So Jesus was there. In Colossians, it tells us that in chapter 1, it tells that Jesus was the firstborn of all creation and was the creator of all things, visible and invisible.
Right.
Principalities and powers, right. Thrones and dominions. So as we move on to the next slide, yes, right there. So we know we're in a spiritual battle.
Right.
And this spiritual battle involves those of us who have given our lives to Jesus. We're in a warfare over the souls of men and women. So here we see that the spiritual warfare is an ongoing battle. And it affects our lives, our daily lives, in a very real sense, like in Israel now. In the spiritual realm, it is spilled over into the physical realm where you have an actual war going on. So the spiritual warfare can and does affect our spiritual lives in a very real sense.
Yes, sir.
If we have received salvation through our faith and belief in Jesus Christ, then we have become soldiers in the Lord's army, fighting the spiritual forces of good and evil in this world. So we're in a battle for the souls of men and women. This is an awesome responsibility that God has given us. Listen at this command, the great commandment that Jesus gave us in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. Jesus came and spake to them saying, this is after his resurrection. Jesus came and spake to them saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. So we see that this responsibility that God has given us for the souls of men and women is an awesome responsibility.
Amen.
For our children.
Yes, Lord.
For our sisters, our brothers, our mothers, uncles, aunts, cousins. Just take a look how this spiritual battle affects us. In 2 Samuel chapter 24, David, pride incited him to number the people and angered God. 2 Samuel chapter 24, and I'd love for you to see these verses so you can go back and read. It says, and David's heart smote him after he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. So the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even into the time appointed. And there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men because of David's pride. And this was the angel of destruction that God had sent. And when the angel, verse 16, and when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, it is enough. Stay now thy hand. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshing place of Araunah, the Jebusite. So we see that Satan is the god of this world and this world's order, this world system. 1 John 5:19. We know that we are children of God and that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. So 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. In whom the god of this world have blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Take a look at this. Take a look at this. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 28 through 29, and this is also recorded in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13, it says, Jesus had just come over from preaching to the people, and they reached the other side of the shore. And that Matthew chapter 8, verse 28 through 29. And when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? We're going to stay right here on this slide for a minute. I want to read it also from Mark chapter 5 and show you something very interesting. Something very, very interesting that I hadn't seen before until God pointed it out to me. Hold on, let me find it in my notes. I apologize here. This is something very interesting. Please bear with me. Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13, I believe, if you want to follow along. Anyway, in Mark chapter 5, it says, it gives us a little more detail about this encounter with the demonic spirits. Here it is, I'm sorry. The destructive nature of the demonic spirits. So this is the same account in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13. It said, and they came over to the other side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit who was dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains. Matthew, in Matthew 8, it gives us the scripture that people were afraid to even go that way because this man was so frightening. It said the man was possessed with devils, and coming out of the tombs, it was exceedingly fierce that no man might pass that way. So it said they tried to bind him with chains and fetters because he had often been bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken pieces. Neither could any man tame him. And always night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, verse 6 in Mark chapter 5, but when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshiped him and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said to him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. A Roman legion was 6,000 men, 6,000 troops. So we're at least 6,000 demons in this man. So he asked him, what is thy name? And he answered, my name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. And the unclean spirits went out, entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. There were about 2,000, and they were choked in the sea. It's a lot in these 13 verses. The violent and the destructive nature of demons, they come to kill, steal, and destroy. You never ever hear of animals committing suicide. Sheep might follow one another. If one jumps off a cliff, the other one would go. If a rat is caught in a trap, the rat will gnaw his leg off just to survive. So this is the violent nature of demons. They bring all kinds of chaos and destruction in our lives. Suicidal thoughts, destructive habits. But it's something very interesting. Even before that, when we look at these two accounts, in the account of Mark, you see verse 6 says, but when he saw Jesus as far off, he ran and worshiped him. Was that the man who went to worship him, or was it demons? They mentioned earlier that the man had no control of himself. He would cut himself. He would scream. So it wasn't the man. The demons went to worship Jesus. They recognized him and called him out by his title. Wow. Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God, I adjure you by God that you don't torment us. Don't send us into the abyss before it's time. Isn't that deep? In Matthew, and we'll just stay with this verse just a little bit longer. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 41, Jesus said, then shall he say also to them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devils and his angels. So the lake of fire was created for the devil and his angels, not for men and women. Men and women choose to go there because they reject Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. But Satan and his demons have already been defeated. And they know that the time is short. But check this out in Mark. It said the demons ran and worshiped him, called Jesus by his title because they recognized his deity. Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God, I adjure thee by God that you torment us not. Don't send us into the abyss. Please send us over to these pigs. It said they besought him. And Jesus told them, come out of the unclean man. But before that, he asked him, what is thy name? And they said, Legion, for we are many, at least 6,000 demons. Verse 10, and the demon besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country, meaning into the abyss, into the darkness where they are bound to go. Verse 11, now there was nigh to the mountain a great herd of swine. Verse 12, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine. Begged him, please, that we may enter into them. And Jesus gave them permission. Isn't that deep? Jesus granted the permission to the demons. He answered their request. How much more do God answer our prayers if he gives the demons their requests? We take prayer for granted. We take prayer for granted. God gave the demons their request because they were due to go into darkness, into the abyss. But he granted them their request. It's deep that God wants to answer our prayers much more than demons. Let's go to the next slide, Melvin. So the appointed time for Satan is Matthew 25:41. Depart from me, ye cursed, into the everlasting fire, prepared for the devils and his angels. As I said, the lake of fire was never prepared for men and women, but men and women will choose to go there because they reject Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So we know that Satan and his devils have already been defeated. Colossians 2:15, and having disarmed the powers and authority, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. So since Satan and his demons know that they've been defeated, that their time is short, they await torment in the lake of fire. Their goal is to drag as many souls of men and women into eternal judgment in the lake of fire that they possibly can. Moving on to the next slide. So for those of us who have given our lives to Christ, Satan's goal is to ensure that he renders our ministry ineffective and that we live out our lives as defeated Christians, ineffective in the power of our resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, knowing this, 2 Corinthians 5:11, Paul tells us, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. We want to persuade our children. We want to persuade the unsaved. Because that's a terrifying thing to see people, just imagine people going into the lake of fire for eternity. And God will hold us accountable. Their blood would be on our hands if we do not share the gospel of Jesus Christ and his great commandment. So in the next slide, before we get there, knowing this terror of the Lord, we have the resurrected power of Jesus Christ available to us through the Holy Spirit to overcome these demonic and evil spiritual forces, but we often fail to utilize them due to what? Our lack of faith, unbelief, lack of spiritual discipline, disobedience, spiritual laziness. 1 John 4:4, ye are of God, little children, have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. And here I just wanted to stop at Luke 10:19 about a warning for misinterpreting the scriptures. Jesus in Luke 10, when he sent disciples out with power, he said, behold, I give you power to tread on serpents and scorpions. The serpent being represented as the devil in scriptures. So I give you power to tread over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. You see, some have unfortunately taken the word of God out of context. So in Virginia, you have this community of snake handlers. In many states, they have outlawed snake handling, because many pastors, preachers, and people have died from snake bites because this is an extreme reach to appear holy, but with severe consequences. See, there's no shortcut to holiness. These snake handlers, they appear so spiritual. People look up to them. They're famous in their communities. One pastor, Eric Wolford in Virginia, was bitten by one of his favorite snakes that was snake handling, died. See, they forget about the part not to tempt God. But it's just, there's no shortcut holiness. These people wanted to appear very holy. But there's no shortcut. So as we look at this slide in Matthew 17, chapter 18, we're still talking about the spiritual warfare, the spiritual battle. There was a man that brought a son to Jesus to cast out a demon. And the disciples couldn't cast him out. But when he brought him to Jesus, he rebuked the devil and he departed out of him. And the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, "Why could we not cast him out?" Jesus said unto him, "Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible to you. Howbeit, verse 21, this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting." So you see, prayer and fasting can strengthen our faith and empower us to walk in the Spirit and overcome the power of the enemy. Sometimes it requires pain and suffering. God hasn't promised us a life of comfort or lack of suffering in this world. We're in enemy territory. So we'll move on from that slide. We just covered that one. So go to the next slide, Melvin. Keep going. Next slide. God's weapons against spiritual warfare. As we quoted earlier in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh in this spiritual warfare. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations in every high thing," or casting down reasoning in every high thing "that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ." What is a stronghold? A stronghold is a place in your life, your thinking, or your mindset, where the enemy has a place of undue influence in our lives, such as drugs, alcohol, sexual addiction, or it could be simply an eating addiction, poor self-image, suicidal thoughts, unbelief. These strongholds can only be overcome by applying the power of Jesus Christ. Ephesians 4:23, "And be renewed in the spirit of your mind." Many strongholds can be demonically influenced, but others can simply be bad habits that we've cultivated on our own throughout our life. And as we come to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18, and we'll read through it again. "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." What are these? They're hierarchies of demons, like in Daniel 10, the prince of Persia and the prince of Greece. In Colossians 1, again, it tells us that Jesus was the firstborn of all creation and created all things, whether invisible, visible, invisible, whether thrones, principalities, powers. So Satan counterfeited everything that Jesus had created, even the spiritual hierarchy. And these are hierarchies of demons that are influencing our government, our world government, United States, Israel, Russia, Iran, Iraq. The next slide goes on and says, "Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, so that we can fight against the deceptions and lies of Satan. Having on the breastplate of righteousness," Proverbs, it tells us, "to guard your heart, for out of it proceed the issues of life. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace," taking every opportunity to share the gospel wherever we can, whether it's work, school, in our households, to our families. "Above all, taking the shield of faith, whereby you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked." And Satan's going to be coming at you. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant. For your adversary, the devil, walk about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And take the helmet of salvation, which covers our minds and our thoughts, where Satan attacks us in such an intense battleground. He attacks our bodies also with sickness and illness. And not all illness and sickness comes from Satan. And not all suffering is due to sin. Like when the disciples asked Jesus about the man born blind. Who sinned, Lord? Was it this man's parents or was it him that he was born blind? Jesus said neither, but that the glory of God might be revealed.
Amen.
So not all suffering is due to sin. But it says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, an offensive weapon. The sword is an offensive and a defensive weapon. When Jesus was tempted, he answered every temptation from Satan with the word of God. He quoted Deuteronomy. Amen. Praying always, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Watch there unto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Supplication, to plead and beg earnestly, humbly before God. If Jesus can grant the request of a demon, how much more will he grant our prayers?
Amen.
James said, you ask and ask amiss because your motives are wrong.
Right.
That's why you receive not. He said, you ask and receive not because your motives are wrong.
Yeah.
So ask God to purify our hearts because he wants to answer our prayers.
Yes.
So as we go into the next slide, just want to say, we're no match for Satan and his powerful demons, so we must rely on the power of the Holy Spirit to conquer these forces.
Amen.
But you know, in Job, God gives us a peek behind the curtain in the sufferings of Job. There's a lot here, a lot to unpack.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's true.
Job, verse 1, verses 6 through 12. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Stop right there. Even Satan has to report to the Lord. The demons, they can't do anything to us or anyone in this universe without his permission. And the Lord said to Satan, whence comest thou? Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, from up and down, walking up and down in it. 1 Peter 5:8, we just quoted the Satan seeks to devour us, walking about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And the Lord said unto Satan, has thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, doth Job fear God for naught? Has thou not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands and the substance of his increase in the land. Put forth thine hand now and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Only upon himself put not forth thy hand. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. Satan and the demonic spirits must receive permission from God before they can touch you. Just like in chapter 5 of Mark, when the demons, Jesus gave them permission, the 6,000 demons, to go into the 2,000 pigs. In the next slide, take a look at this. In verse 10, Satan said, has thou not made a hedge about him, about his house, and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands and the substance of his increase. God's hedge of protection was around Job and his entire family. Satan admitted, in all his possessions. So when we live in disobedience and unrepentant lies, God can take away this hedge of protection.
Yeah.
It can affect our entire family as well as all of our possessions. There's a lot that God wanted to teach us in this verse. God can remove this hedge of protection at any time for any reason. Check this out. Such as character building, partaking of Christ's sufferings, as in Job's experience. We see that in 1 Peter 4:12, Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you. But what? But rejoice. And be exceedingly glad, for you are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory may be revealed, you may be glad also. 1 Peter 1, 7 through 12. Knowing the trial of your faith is much more precious than gold. God wants to build our character. In 2 Corinthians 12, Paul besought the Lord that he might remove the thorn of flesh. But Jesus told him, my strength is made perfect in weakness. So God removed that hedge of protection so that it would keep Paul humble. So for disobedience, God can remove this hedge of protection. Look at 1 Corinthians 5, 5, when Paul was talking about the incestuous church brother that was sleeping with his father's wife. He said, deliver that one up to Satan that his flesh may be destroyed, but his spirit might be saved in the day of the Lord. In 1 Corinthians 11, when it talks about disorder at the communion's table, for this reason many sleep, many are weak and sickly, and many have died because they came to the Lord's table with disobedience and they had iniquity in their hearts. So God can remove that hedge of protection. Just like we talked about in Revelation 2:20, the sexually immoral saints said the woman of Jezebel was teaching fornication and other sexual immoralities. And he said they will suffer intensely. So God can move that hedge of protection for disobedience. So in concluding on this part one, we are involved in a spiritual warfare, a battle for the souls of men and women. And as soldiers, we must prepare ourselves using God's weapons, yes, his armor. The weapons of our warfare are prayer, fasting, the armor of God, if he can grant a demon's request, then he most certainly will grant yours. In the last part of this part one, I just want to share something. It may be offensive to a lot of us, but spiritual discernment is something that is somewhat lacking in the church as a whole. I talked about in the sermon about the seven churches. In Revelation 20, it said, nevertheless, I have this against you. Verses 2 and verses 20 on through there, he said, you have this woman there that calls herself a prophetess. And he didn't call her name Jezebel, but she was like Jezebel. In Elijah, when I preached that sermon, Jezebel was Ahab's wife, but her name is forever enshrined because she represents iniquity, sexual immorality, the worst of evil. As you read in the scriptures, it kind of tells us that the prophet sat at Jezebel's table. Even though King Ahab was a man and leader, Jezebel was a manipulative, controlling spirit. And this carried on throughout all time. Jezebel, the spirit of Jezebel is not a man or woman, but it represents evil and immorality, such as Revelation chapter 2. But we need the spirit of discernment to recognize these evil forces. In Revelation chapter 2, it tells us that these wicked forces are operational in the church, but we must have discernment to see them. 1 Timothy 4:1, and the Spirit speaks expressly in the last days that men and women will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of demons. These are in the church. And like I said, some of this may offend you because all of this is operational in church, but we have to have spiritual eyes and ears to see. And I don't like to call out some of these celebrity Christians by name, but I'll refer to them as pseudonyms. Medea. Church folks made Medea rich, catapulted him into billionaire status. But he did something that RuPaul couldn't do. He got us the church to accept drag, homosexual stuff. There are videos online of Mr. and Mrs. Medea in the pulpit of these mega church pastors. You can go on YouTube and you can see it. So he's in, what would I call him? C.D. Blake's He's in C.D. Blakes' church. You all know what I'm saying. And he said, the Lord just told me to give you $1 million. He starts speaking in tongues. Ah, bah, 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 bah. Goes over, lays his hands on Brother C.D.'s head. Brother C.D. shakes and starts speaking in tongues. Celebrity Christians. Kanye is another celebrity Christian. But we pray for all of them. They fell back into this demonic ways. But look, look, look what happens. These celebrity Christians are all in the mega church pulpit, preaching to tens of thousands of people. But what does he do when he goes back to make his movies and productions? Every sin of immorality, homosexuality, fornication, adultery, greed, lust. But you know, millions of Christians, we watch these programs. I told you, I'm gonna step on some folks' toes. But you know, God gives a spiritual discernment. What is he saying? Revelation 2:20. This woman, this prophetess, this Jezebel, teaches my servants to commit adultery and eat food sacrificed to idols. See, we have to be spiritually aware and spiritually discerning that these false prophets are operational in the church today.
Amen.
And we have to be spiritually aware.
Yes, Lord.
You see, the masses flock to these people. It's great entertainment. And don't get me wrong, Medea had some great uplifting stuff that he or she first put out. But the demonic forces that are behind it, the sexual malady, that's all you see on TV. Goes in the church pulpit, as soon as you get back in the studio, all this demonic stuff. But it influences us. We open ourselves up to influence of these demonic forces when we watch this stuff, when we listen to it. So be aware of the spiritual battle that's going on. Even though we may not be aware of it, it affects our daily lives. We're being bombarded by every demonic force because we are in a battle for the souls of men and women. Because salvation in the end is the most important thing. We don't want to see anybody in our family, our children, our loved ones, our aunts, uncles, mothers, sisters, brothers. It is our mission to go forth and make disciples of them, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to obey whatever commands Jesus has taught us. It's an awesome responsibility. And it's not my intention to offend anybody, but I have an awesome responsibility before God. If I stand in this pulpit, I have to speak that word of truth.
Yes.
Or the blood of these people is on my hands, on our hands. No matter who it offends, it offends our children, our wives, husbands, sisters, brothers. So, and it's part one of the spiritual battle. Let's be aware. Let's pray. Let's fast. Call on God. Our corporate prayer is so important. Our individual prayer is so important. So, with that said, bow your heads with me, please. And let's ask God to help us to walk closely with him, to be empowered to fight the spiritual battle, these spiritual warfares, that we might put on the whole armor of God, praying, fasting, because we're already victorious in this battle. We just have to trust the Lord.
Amen.
Father, give us the grace. Give us the willingness to submit to you, to empower us to walk in the Spirit, to be obedient, to fight the spiritual battle. Even though we may get tired in his bodies, God, we know that Satan will attack our bodies. He will attack our minds. But give us grace. Give us strength, Lord, as we soldier on, knowing that the trying of a faith is more precious than gold. Thank you, Lord, for this word. May we receive it and be blessed, Lord, to walk in you. In the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. God bless you.
Indeed. That's a hard topic to tackle, but guess what? We need to hear it. As believers, sometimes we want to coddle our Christianity and the Bible as if we, you know, we got to defend it and some things we can't say. But it's in the Word. John didn't speak anything outside of the Word of God today. So when you know better, you do better.
Amen.
We're going to close out on our song with this song, Onward Christian Soldiers. You can find it in your hymnal on 731. Would you stand with me as we close out? And let this be our rally cry. You know, we got to fight this thing. God has won the war for us. Jesus' death and resurrection is, my goodness, it's sealed it. But we got to live it out now.
Amen.
We got to live it out.
Onward Christian Soldiers, page 731.
Of the spiritual warfare that we are involved in, that the souls of men and women, our children, are at stake, that Jesus has commanded us to go forth and make disciples of them. May the Lord lead us and guide us and keep our minds always in His will. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion, and power, both now and evermore. May the church say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Go in peace.
Amen.
Amen.
Good word, John.
Yeah.
Tell you, man. I just pray that we can follow. Challenge, but it's what we call it too. But you know what? I've learned something. Prayer and fasting, the corporate prayer is so important. The prayer and fasting, I still have to learn, you know, saving the task. But that willpower, like it's just a reading pushing forward.
Yeah.
Yeah.